As you know, I flew in the Royal Air Force. I was a navigator for 20 years, so I go back quite a long way in the types of equipment we had. We in Bomber Command mainly used an awful lot of radar. It was developed in the early 30s. Actually, it's more people coming in. Back in 33, just about everybody in Europe, and even over in America, they were using the Lorenz beams. They were basically a dot-dash type of system. When you got a continuous note, you were getting a direct signal from the actual transmitter.
And did you say 1933?
Yep.
Okay. You must be very old.
Yeah. One of the things, the radar is a term that came into being in 1943. Before that, it was known as RDF, Radio Direction Finding. That actual term is now standard issue as a everyday expression. In 1934, Germany had a radar, technically called as such, it was called SETAKT, SWETAKT, and it was mainly a gun laying radar, had a range of about 500 yards. In 1935, a guy called Robert Watson Wyatt, a Scottish scientist, put a proposal up to the Air Ministry. He did it on the 12th of February, to be exact. A couple of weeks later, he got an answer back that they would go ahead and fund his project. And what he was suggesting was a radar chain and also a VHF control for fighter aircraft with the four-channel range on the radios, which is a pretty big step forward. They went ahead with that, and by 1936, they built their first station. Anyway, this is the first one that they built, the CH station. This was 300 feet tall. They had an array of them, and this was the actual layout that they produced just in time for the start of World War II. We had one set up in Scotland, but this was the main one for the air defense in the south of England. Because in World War I, we've been bombed in the southern part of England, both by Zeppelins and by heavy bombers from operating out of France and Germany. So the nonsense that was going on in Germany in the 30s with Hitler coming to power, it was obvious to an awful lot of people, especially Churchill, that the conflict was not too far away. So we got it built just in the right time for that setup. Germany went out to sleep either. Because just about every nation, America, Britain, even Japan, get the Yagi antennas, which we still use even today on these aircraft around here, all came along at about the same spec. We were all working on metric radar systems. In other words, the frequency was a metric wavelength setup. The Germans had a gun-laying radar called Wurzburg. I'll spell it out, WRXBURG, had a range of about 25 miles. And they also had another radar called a Freya. And Freya was unknown at that time as to what the code name meant. We had a scientist called Dr. Jones, and he was appointed in charge of the intelligence setup in Britain at the time. And he did a bit of research, and Freya was a code name, actually it was a folklore of a Nordic goddess of beauty and fertility and all sorts of neat stuff. And she had a right-hand man who called Findel, and he was capable of seeing to gather very precious jewelry, and he was able to look in every direction, day or night. So that gave us the clue as to what the radar did. And by the beginning of the war, in 39, they had eight of these sets operating. Two of them were in Heligoland, a couple in Wangaroos, which is the northern Persian Isles, a couple on Silk, one in Borkum, and one in Norgum. And that was giving them a range of about 25 miles. And that was a control radar. You could control aircraft wide, rather like our GH setup, CH chain home stations in Britain. In 1937, going back a little bit in time again, there was a guy called Dr. R.J. Dibby, kind of an oddball name, and he invented a system called G. hyperbolic curves. And that gave rise to an awful lot of good equipment. We had the Loran radar, Loran 1, Loran A and C, DECA, all of them, GH, and a German system known as hyperbol. These microwaves, I've got a G chart here actually, which I'll pass around to give you some idea how we operate. But G is basically three, four transmitters. Each hooked up to each other. The master one, A, would transmit a signal. It would be received at these three other stations. They would then transmit, and by coding them, they had red, blue, green, as you'll see on this thing here, and purple. The navigator would get these, pick them up on his G-box, and be able to plot a fix. He only needed two of them to get a good fix. It was limited in range to about 300 miles. Anyway, that was what came along in 1937. That didn't get into service until about 1941. So by 1938, we had our chain home setup complete. Jamming at that time was not fairly well known, but once you transmit on something, you can get receive that signal. And if you know what the frequency is, you can send a more powerful signal back and jam it completely so it nullifies the equipment. And we tested one. They had a code name, and there were big on code names in World War II, one called Bromide. And Bromide was actually a diathermal machine from a hospital. They mounted it in a Sunderland flying boat, which is a pretty big target for radar reception. And they used that to test it against our CH stations, and it worked very, very well indeed. So of course you had to have it exactly at the aircraft, the city you wanted to protect. But we'll get to that further down the line. The war started, as you know, on the 3rd of September 1939, and Britain at that time, we didn't have much in the way of really long-range bomber aircraft. Our bomber force was pretty ancient stuff, and about the most modern one we had was the Vickers Wellington, which was a cloth-covered bomber, actually. It was the aluminum frame, of course, and geodetic construction, and the guy that designed that particular structure, the guy called Barnes Waterson, who became famous with the bouncing bomb that I'll mention later on with the Danbuster there. Anyway, that was our most technical aircraft at the time. The Germans, they had what they called the Oslo Report, came in the November of 1939, and that listed all sorts of good intelligence coming out of that, mainly Poland. Gave us information on guided weapon technology, rockets that were being tested at Peenemünde, and we also got one of the famous Enigma machines, which is sort of hazy as to where that actually came from. We believe it was a Polish major somehow got a hold of one and they gave it over, and we got all that intelligence from them direct. As a result of that, we gave the Norwegians some anti-aircraft weapons to protect themselves in exchange for that piece of equipment. It was a pretty good trade-off. Unfortunately, one of the things we did find out, they had a rocket land in Norway, and they gave us the rocket, but unfortunately it was a guided weapon system, and we assumed, unfortunately wrongly, that was the frequency that we're going to be operating the B-2 on, and we jammed that frequency continuously for the rest of the war. Unfortunately, it didn't apply to anything at all, so it was a waste of effort, but we didn't find that out until after the war. Anyway, in December of 1939, the phony war, as they called it, was still going on, and not an awful lot happening in the West, as the Germans were mainly facing east and rushing through Poland. We trapped the German pocket battleship, the Graf Spee, down in Montevideo, South America and the South Atlantic, and eventually the ship scuttled itself, but it didn't sink completely, and fortunately for us, we got one of the SeaTac radars complete. Now, by that time, they had developed it to giving it a range of 9 miles, and that was what they were using on the Scharnhorst when they sunk the Hood. It was just one salvo of three shells. One of them hit it in the ammunition bunker, and the whole thing blew up. Three sailors survived. Anyway, that gives a start of what the Germans were doing. By February 1940, we had two scientists, a Dr. Randall and a Dr. Boot, B-O-O-T, and they developed a thing called the magnetron valve. They were working for GEC down at Wembley, and this was the first production centimetric equipment that they developed, capable of 10 kilowatts of power. and centimetric changed everything in the war. In fact, it changed everything, period. You've got one of these magnetron valves in the microwave oven. It was found out one guy working on it with a candy bar in his pocket and chocolate melted and the radar kept passing over it, hence the microwave. And if you remember, when they first came in, they were known as radar ranges built by a man. So that goes all the way back to World War II in 1940. We passed that on, but we didn't do that until about September 1941, when Professor Henry Tizard, who was one of our top scientists, was on a mission to Washington, trying to get some planes and equipment, because America wasn't in the war at that time. So, Pearl Harbor hadn't arrived 2 months later. Anyway, we gave that in exchange to the aircraft, for the aircraft. They worked out pretty well. We had, of course, the Americans took it over. It was Bell Laboratories. Later went bananas on this, and they changed everything very dramatically. And within the space of about 15, 18 months, they developed a very fine night fighting radar. But I'll come to that later on. But the first use that we used on the magnetron valve was in our airborne radar, AI. It was the Mark 8. Americans used an ABC, which is a logical way of doing things. The British used Mark 1, Mark 2, Mark 3. And just to confuse everybody, he used Roman numerals. So everybody's running around looking up Latin books to find out what the hell the equipment stands for. Anyway, we developed H2S, which was a see-through cloud type of radar. We had our anti-submarine vessel radar come in as well. And of course, the Americans came up with the SCR 720, which became later known as the Mark 10 radar. Anyway, after Dunkirk, when the Germans had occupied all of northern France and pretty much everything, we had a Spitfire doing reconnaissance work over the north French coast and managed to get a picture of one of these Freya radar sites fairly close to the coast. And of course, what you did then, by then we had established some radio countermeasure, not a squadron, it wasn't that big, but a small wing of aircraft. And a wing of aircraft in the Royal Air Force is the same as a group in the 8th Air Force, so the terms are kind of reversed, so you keep that in mind. The guy in charge of that was a guy called Commander Addison, who was later promoted to an air marshal, vice marshal rather, by the end of the war. The Battle of Britain, of course, came and went, and we survived that, mainly due to the radar set up here and the fact that we were able to plot the Germans. Now, these CH stations had a range of 120 miles, which was pretty darn good in those days, and they had an arc of about 120 degrees. So they covered the whole area around the coastal section quite well. In Scotland, we were mainly concerned. They had one station up here on the coast, and that was looking to the east, because they were bombing Scotland from Norway. It was a shorter run for them. So they had a long sea crossing, and then our main targets in Scotland were Clyde Bank on the west coast, where they built the Queen Mary, and they were building the Queen Elizabeth at that time. She was still in dry dock then, being finished off, and they put all the fittings, shot her over to America and finished it off there. On the east side, there was the Navy side down at the Rosyth, mainly heavy ships down there, and then we had the Orkney Islands up at the top end there as well. So that was the attack mode from the northern part, but everything else came from the continent. The Germans switched from daylight bombing after the Battle of Britain and went to night bombing. And the first big raid that they did, they did obviously London, but one of the, let's go to the next one here, they developed a thing called the Garat beam, the X beam. And you see the main approach beam here. And this one gives you a pretty good idea as how the system worked. They had three cross beams on the right over here, going up there. When the aircraft received the signal here, they had about 15 miles to go to point B. They'd settle down on track. At point B, they'd get the other signal. When he received that, the navigator would start a clock. It would run for 3 minutes. They're doing 180 miles an hour, so not much. 3 miles a minute on the ground. When they reached point C, the bombs would drop automatically, and that point was calculated for the height they were at, and then the trajectory of the bombs, and it hit the city of Coventry. That's how the beam worked. That's when we used a bromide device, but as I mentioned before, we had to mark them actually on the ground at Coventry to be able to jam these beams. They further developed into what they called the Y version of it, and that was fully automatic. And of course, by then, we were monitoring all these things with different types of aircraft and picking up these signals, so we knew the frequencies of just about everything. And of course, once you know the where it's being transmitted from, then you can attack the target as need be. When they went to the Y system, that changed everything because it was fully automatic. But once we'd figured out where we were transmitting from, we instead of using these bromide or the diathermy early crude type of system, we switched to using the BBC, and it had rules of power, and they just swamped it and stopped it cold. So that pretty well finished that type of attack. This gives you some more idea of the various stations, because they weren't only just attacking Manchester, Liverpool, all the big cities down here, and down on the west coast as well. But they were pretty well stationed all the way around with the different types of beams, with the other types of stations here. You could lay the track down, and the aircraft would just fly right up it, and then they'd get the cross beams coming in from the other side. Very simple setup, but it worked very, very well. Of course, once we nailed it down, it was quite easy. The Coventry raid is worth mentioning because when they started bombing Coventry, it was one of the classic firestorms of the early ones. A firestorm is where you generate so much fire on the ground that it feeds on itself. It burns up all the oxygen in the air, and people die of asphyxiation. We didn't get into that big deal numbers until 43 on Hadlow. But Coventry was the sort of precursor of what was going to happen. They sent 449 bombers to attack Coventry. They dropped 394 tons of high explosive, 56 tons of incendiaries, 127 aerial mines, and left 400 dead and 800 injured. One of the problems the Germans had was the fact that their air force was basically tied as long-range cannon for the infantry. They didn't develop a strategic bomber force at all. So as a result, they got the fire started, but they had to go back to France, rearm, and then come back again. In that period of time, the fire service were able to get a hold of a bit of control of the fires, and naturally, it burned quite a lot, but it wasn't the firestorm that it could have happened if they'd had a bigger bomb going to begin with. So that was one of the failures of the German Luftwaffe in that respect. They didn't carry a big enough bomb load in their bombers compared to what we could do on our planes in Halifax and later on. In Germany, in 1940, they promoted a guy, Colonel Joseph Kammhuber, and he was the guy that designed the Kammhuber line. And this was I'll show a bit more of it here. This one is your Freya radar. And these were based along the coast. They doubled the range up to 50 miles now. And this is a control unit, because the, gives you a better shot of it here. That's the Wurzburg radar. You can see the controller sits inside. He would actually control the fighter, the night fighter, on that one. The other one would feed the information in. And they had a similar setup to what we did in the Battle of Britain, control center, where all the information was fed in, and they'd operate accordingly from there. This is the biggest one they had, the Mammut, the Bengish radar. This rather like our CH stations. It had a range of 200 miles, but it was fixed, rather like our CH stations were on the coast. I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself there. When they spotted the Wurzburg on the coast, they gave us the information that we needed to develop the countermeasures for it. We decided on a commando raid, which they did carry out because it's fairly close to the coast. As a result of that, they used about a dozen Whitley aircraft, which was a twin-engine bomber, not a particularly good one, but it was at least made of metal. And they carried in about, 122 troops. They captured one of the operators, and they escaped, bringing back the amplifiers, the dipole, all the bits and pieces that you needed to know, back on motor torpedo boats, which is rather like a PT boat. And they got the equipment back to the UK. As a result of the raid, the Germans moved all their Wurzburg stations further inland, so we couldn't do another raid again. But they made the mistake of identifying them by building defensive wires and barricades around them as well, so they were much easier to find. This thing here, by the way, is about the size of a tennis court. about 90 feet long and about 30 feet high. So it's a pretty big piece of machinery. They also had one vital piece of equipment, which is still a problem even today. This is called the Wasserman, and that was a vertical height-finding radar. It was very difficult to get accurate heights on equipment. Don't forget, in those days, we're talking 60, 70 years ago, compared to what we have now, you'd think nothing of it. But in those days, this was high-tech stuff. It was the best height-finding unit used anywhere in the world at that time. They also had a night fighter radar called the Kinstein, and we didn't know much about that. It had a range, of, which we didn't find out until after, much later in the war, when we captured one complete. But it had a range of about 1 to 2 miles. And working in those days, they were working on metric. And our AI Mark 8 radar, until we got the magnetron valve, our only effect was the higher you went up, the greater the range you would get, because the spillover from the radar dish would pick up ground returns and reflect back, and you couldn't pick out the night bomber on the radar scope. So when we got the magnetron valve and we got the SCR-720, I'll get to that just a moment. Anyway, by the end of 1942, to sort of summarize, Germany was destroying about 4% of our bombers at night. And we went to night bombing for very simple reasons. Daylight work with the equipment that we had in those days, the navigator had astro shooting the stars with a sextant, not a sextant. You had maps, you could look at the ground if you could see the ground, easy to pick up coastlines and so on. Mapping in Europe was pretty well covered very extensively before the war, so we knew where everything was. You had radio bearings which weren't particularly reliable, and of course they decreased with range, and you were subject to the problems with the appleton lane where the radio signals were being dispersed and reflected around. So you had all these things going, and that was about it. Compasses were not the greatest at that point in time. So by the beginning of 42, we had what came out was a big special report on the effectiveness of night bomb of bombing over Germany. And the average accuracy was within, if you were within 60 miles of the target, you were damn lucky. It was that bad. Because flying over Germany, it's not like here we have weather like this 90% of the time. Over Germany, you have smoke, haze, and cloud, and a lot of it. It was a tremendous amount of weather. You're much, much further north. If you go east from here, you go down through the Mediterranean. When you go over Germany, you're about 30 degrees further higher up. So you're about 1,500 miles further north from where we are right now. So the weather in that neck of the woods is always pretty bad because you get closer to the Arctic. Effects of the polar winds coming out of there. So the Brits then switched to night bombing because that was even worse because in daylight we were being butchered. We started the war with 200 bombers and we reached a point where we had six, we were losing 50% in every daylight mission. So if the numbers that they had, they had five more missions left and the bomber command would cease to exist. So that's when they switched to night bomb because then we ran into all the problems. Navigation. So it was obvious we needed help, and the radar people, TRE, that was the Telecommunications Research Establishment, it was manned 50-50 with Brits and Americans. When the Americans came into the war, they came over there in droves, and they were very essential to the effectiveness of the development of radar for everybody in World War II. So here we had the Germans. We were using night bombing, and the Germans were destroying about 4% of our bombers every night we went out over Germany. We didn't find this out until after the war, but I'll give you some numbers here. They had 265 night fighters, and they had about 140 available every night. They had 60 airborne radar sets being produced per month. They had 185 of these giant works girders that we had there. They had, half of that was done by the end of 42, and they were building them at the rate of 30 a month, and that was to fill the Kamhuber line. And this is the start of it here, but you'll get a better view of this one. Give you some idea of what it was like over Germany. But coming back to this one here, Witzel on the map had measles, but each one of these means something. And if you give me just a second, I'll point them out to you one at a time. The effectiveness of this was very, very good indeed. This stretched from Norway all the way down to the west coast of France. It was 200 miles deep, and it was filled up with the square ones here. If you'll show up around on this thing, the square boxes are difficult to see them, but these were the FRAIR radars. The circular ones were the Wurzburg sets. The ones with the triangles on them up near the coast, able to see tax, that was the one we could use, we were using against shipping. They had the dots with the observer cores, and these are the reporting centers, these sections up here. So it gives you some idea just how good that thing was. This was the searchlight belt all the way along. And of course, all the major cities have searchlights around them. These were heavy targets. A lot of you have been there and know more about them than I did, because I've been doing half of these things anyway. So you can see the ranges of all the radar sets of what they had, and you have to be able to penetrate. So at that point in time, the bomber command was just coming into it. So we were starting to get four-engine heavy bombers, and the first ones were the Stirling. The Stirling bomber was one of the best bombers they ever built, but it had a major problem. Now, when they designed it, they had a wingspan of 120 feet. Now, all the hangars that had been built in the 1930s for the aircraft could only take a 100-foot aircraft span. So to get them in the hangar, they had to chop the wingspan in the Stirling. As a result of that, it wouldn't get up much beyond 14,000 feet. But when it's up there flying, it's difficult to get off the ground because they've only had the one fin and rudder at the back end. And I've flown in them after the war, and it was quite an achievement. The undercarriage retracted in a manner which is almost impossible to describe. It came back on sight, and it did all sorts of weird stuff. It eventually got the wheels out of the way. Once it was in the air, it flew like a fighter, a very handy aircraft to fly. And the crews that flew them liked them, but they were sitting ducks at 14,000 because other than the 88mm cannon, which was the standard anti-aircraft gun, the standard anti-tank gun. It was used on tanks and the exceptional weapon, and it was used as a field gun as well. So it's a very good weapon. But the light flak would get up to around 14,000 feet with the Oerlikon cannon and so on. So they were pretty well sitting ducks at that level. And eventually they were replaced when they got more Lancasters. And the Halifax, the early one, the one that I flew had the radial engines, which came along much later in the war. But the early ones had Merlins, and they were limited because they didn't have the Merlin that was in the Hurricane and Spitfire. It was a much lesser powered one, and it was never designed for the Halifax because the Halifax was designed to take a mid-engine on the wing, and these things stuck up the top of the wing, and the result was the flame dampers weren't very effective. You could see the exhaust ducts when you passed over the top of the damn things, and made them very good prey to knife fighters. Also, the early ones had a bit of a stabilizer problem. If you did a corkscrew maneuver, you could get rudder stalled, and you just corkscrew right into the ground. A corkscrew maneuver is rather like if you're flying along like this, and a fighter comes up behind you, and they call the gun calls for a corkscrew. You roll over and dive down, roll around, come up, and you virtually went through the air in that sort of motion. Very wild, and the idea was you would shake off the fighter, which hopefully you did. Because if you found if the fighter knew you spotted them, there was no point chasing you. Pick someone who was half asleep and shoot them down. So that was the way that side worked. Radar jamming, I've mentioned what we were doing with the bromide system against the German beams. We didn't do much else because we didn't want to start jamming some German radars because they could jam ours. And at that time, the Germans were still capable of coming and attacking Britain quite heavily. And Fighter Command put skids on using jamming at first. And it wasn't until the German battle cruisers, Scharnhorst and Meissner, scooted on through the channel, and they jammed the CH stations in Britain. That gave us the green light that it was fair game, as nobody really wanted to start doing it. They started it, we continued and amplified it 1,000-fold from then on out. The general effect of what was happening in Bomber Command was by Fighter Command, oddly enough, started the jamming for us. They used the Defiant, which was a single-engine fighter that that had a gun turret on it. It didn't have forward firing guns, that had a bolt ball turret in the back with a gun around it. It was used about once or twice in the Battle of Britain when the Germans figured out what it was pretty well useless and they shot them all down. But we adapted them and used them as a night fighter. And we also used them to develop a thing called moonshot. And this was our first radar jamming of the Freya radar stations in France. And they tested it with about eight of these fighters. And they went out there and it worked like a charm. The Germans, what they were doing, moonshine, what it did, it took in the pulses coming from the Freya radar station, amplified them and sent them back. So the Germans got the impression that there was more than just eight aircraft coming in. There were about 30 or 40 of them. And they scrambled about 40 fighters to go up and intercept them. Of course, they switched off and went back to base. But it proved that the system worked. So that was our first effort at doing it. As a result of that, and the fact that we were then given a green light to go ahead and start jamming big time. Now, they worked in with the Freya, and on the 6th of August, 1942, they were limited to one aircraft, the Moonshine, to one Freya radar set. And on that day, it was the first American raid to Rouen in France, and it jammed it very, very completely, so we were able to help the B-17s on their first mission over France at that point in time. One of the big benefits of 1942 was we captured one of these Freya radar sets in North Africa, shipped it back, and then TRE got a hold of it again and made it all work. So we had the radar guys that we captured in the Brunnenval raid when we got the Wurzburg people. So all this combination of intelligence got the thing up and working. And we moved it up into Scotland, and we tested it up there as a useful tool that we would be able to jam it on D-Day. And I'll get into that later on. By now, Bomber Command, instead of radio bearings, maps, and astro navigation, we started to get G. And G was that was set up here. You can see the master station and the three slave stations all transmitting, and how we got our signals that way. And we equipped three Wellington bombers with the G set and tested it. Unfortunately, one of them shot down. That was in in March of 42. So within 3 months, they started jamming G. So they captured one of the sets, and of course, once you've got it, you can figure out what it does and work backwards from there. But by the beginning of 42, March of 42, about a third of Bomber Command was equipped with G, so we had navigation going. Now, what G did for the Royal Bomber Command forces was it gave us concentration. Before, we'd been sort of haphazard getting into targets in Germany, but with G, we could navigate and get concentration over a target. Now, a bomber raid at night is basically, if you take a chunk of sky 9 miles long, 3 miles wide, and a mile deep, and you take that and fill it with 1,000 aircraft all going in different directions, the chances of hitting each other, oddly enough, is surprisingly small. And if you make them all go the same way, it goes down to practically nothing. So that was the start of the bomber stream. What happened in 42 was that Air Marshal Harris took over the control of Bomber Command. He was looking for something spectacular to get, because everybody was fighting for the equipment and money to buy and build this, that, and the other. The Navy, Army, and Air Force, everybody wanted more money for everything, naturally. It hasn't changed much even today. Anyway, he decided for a spectacular type raid, mount 1,000 bombers, and they picked the target, it was Cologne. That was on the 30th of May, 1942. And 1,000 bombers had never been done before. And actually, they got 1,046. But by having G, and everything that flew, twin engines, anything that had two engines that could carry a bomb of any size, went to Cologne that night. They poached the aircraft from the Navy, from the Coastal Command, just to be able to get that big number. Because the number of heavy bombers at that time kind of limited to the Stirling and the early Halifax. The Lank hadn't come along then. We had the Manchester at that time, which was really a twin-engine Lancaster, which didn't work at all. I spent 20 years in the Air Force. I never met anybody who flew in Manchester. They either died in the damn things or they were lucky to get out of there early on. Anyway, the raid was quite successful. It completely swamped the boxes because the Freya radars would pick up the the planes coming in. Then they would turn the information over to the Wurzburg radar, who would control the night fighter and vector them in. So it was a one-on-one relationship. By getting so many coming through in a one fell swoop, it just drenched everything. The controllers had no idea where half the aircraft were, and difficult to vector fighters because there were so many in the sky. And there were so many blips on the screen, sorting them all out was a real headache. So the raid lasted about, I think the actual amount of time was about 90 minutes. So that's quite a long raid. So you had 1,000 aircraft going over the city. The results were pretty spectacular, as the casualty figures were very, very small indeed. We lost 34 aircraft. That's a 3.9 loss rate, which is acceptable. As high as you can go on a bomber fleet is about 5%, because you can replace aircraft, but it's much, much longer to train crews. So once you pass 5, you're on the wrong side of the curve. So this was a major step forward. We could stand up to that amount of enemy. By the summer of 1942, we were starting to, this again shows you the actual effect of the Kanhuber line all the way up. You can see Denmark is up here, all the way down the coast around France. Coming over here is the channel coming through here. And Dover is right here, Calvin to Dover right there. Gives you some idea. This gives you a much better thing, for secret that was a long time ago when this was. A slide was made, obviously. You get a better group of idea just how thick that Kanhuber line was. And you had to punch your way through that. Of course, that was there in the daytime as well. But I'll cover that a little bit further on. One of the things we did not know, we knew pretty much everything about what was going on with the radars. We developed a codenamed Mandrel, which was designed specifically to jam FRAIR radar signals. Now, as you can see, we got an awful lot of FRAIR radar stations up and down the coast there. So we had to have one aircraft per station. Actually, it was easier if we had two aircraft, which is the way we did it. And that would go on day and night. So when the B-17s and 24s were going out in the daytime, we had a group called 100 Group. This was a specialist group. We had B-17s, we eventually got B-24s, we had Stirlings, we had Hudsons, we had B-25s, all sorts of aircraft, all carrying different types of radar equipment to jam German radar. So when the B-17s were briefed, while they were at briefing, our guys in the 100 group would be getting the same information. They'd be up and they would control specific points on the English coast up and down here or just off the coast, and they would jam every radar set there. So the Germans would not be able to see the B-17s getting into formation over England until they get up to that altitude. Then when they started crossing the North Sea or the Channel, they could pick up the vapor trails and so on. But this gave them some sort of protection while they were on their way up. So it worked very, very well indeed. One of the things we did not know in the 42 was the German night fighter radar, how it was working. And we were picking up radio transmissions, and the code word here would be Emil, Emil. So obviously it's something to do with the night fighters. But we assumed that they were using radar for the night fighting technology like we were, or maybe they were using infrared, that we didn't know. So they fitted up one Wellington with all sorts of receiving equipment in it. And they went out as bait, and they were obviously picked up in the Freyers and Wurzburgs, and then a fighter was sent up to intercept them, which it did. But it was transmitting the signals, and they were able to pick up the signals. Of course, in the process, they almost got shot down. They were badly shot up, but they got the information they wanted. So we now knew everything about what the Germans were doing with radar and the frequencies that they were operating on. Better speed it up here. In the bombers, we weren't completely useless. We have what we call tinsel. And this was a technique where the wireless operator at briefing would be given a range of frequencies that he would tune into with his radio set. When he heard any German-speaking voices, he could switch, throw a switch, he would pick up the supercharger on the engine and transmit nothing but noise on that frequency. And of course, that limited you to what you could do with it, but it worked pretty well. It would only jam radio RT transmissions, sophisticated up to the fighter. They couldn't do anything against the radar site. We had window, which is now known as chaff. And window in those days, we wanted to use it early on because it gives you tremendous protection. But fighter command didn't want to do that because the Germany, having gone and started fighting against the Russians, they were heavily involved there, so the threat against Britain wasn't that bad. So they eventually gave us the green light. The first time they used it was against Hamburg, but I'll cover that in just a moment. Before we get to Hamburg, I'd better touch on the radar site again with the H2S. I mentioned we got our AI Mark 8, the centimetric radar. H2S was basically, well, if you're chemically inclined, it's hydrogen sulfide. In other words, that's stink bomb stuff that you used to throw around in schools in the Keller youth. Anyway, H2S was the ground mapping device, and it didn't exactly, here you see it here. This is the actual coming into Wilhelmshaven. You can see the coastline here, the Frisian Isles with Wangerooge Rouge up in the top left up there. And this is what the navigator would see on his screen. It didn't give you pinpoint accuracy for bombing. It was just a generalization. But it was very useful for us because we did a lot of mine laying. We sank more ships by Bomber Command than the Navy did in World War II. I don't like to mention that, but Navy being navies. But anyway, as you can see here, you've got a very definite sign of the coastline, and you could offset your screen, and you could drop your mine extremely accurately, using a G-fix as well. But at that range out here, you would be not too accurate with G, because you're more than 300 miles away. Actually, shuts off pretty well at the Ruhr. This is getting pretty close to about 450, 500 miles out from England. But you could pinpoint very accurately where you're dropping the mine, and they sank a hell of a lot of ships because they were coming down from Norway and Sweden, mainly bottle bearings, and the traffic around there with the oil coming from the captured mines in Norway were coming down into Germany in this area here. So this is what the H2S looked like. We had what we call fish pond. And fish pond, the navigator would have to turn off his H2S, but then the wireless operator would then take over. And he would take the center cone of the antenna, which is underneath the aircraft, spinning at 360 degrees, and that would look up 360 degrees around the aircraft, and it would be up to 5 degrees above the horizontal. So he could pick up every other aircraft in the bomber stream. If you see a little blip coming in towards you, then you could wake up the rear gunner at the back end, so he could make sure to pick him up on his way in visually as well. So that was kind of useful for us as well. We also had on the bomber a thing called Moniker, and this was a rearward-looking radar that we had, and it had a little bubble about a year ago with a scanner inside it, and this gave the gunner a picture behind him, and that would pick up fighters coming in. The trouble was, and we didn't find out until one of the German Ju-88s landed in England by mistake, and had been on patrol in the North Sea, and got lost and ran out of fuel and landed in Woodbridge in England on the East Coast. And if you want to see that aeroplane, it's in the RAF Museum at Hendon in London. It's been there for posterity, kind of a handy thing. That was when we found out that they were able to home on the Moniker transmissions. And of course, this was much later than when we started on our bombing raids. So it was kind of a useful thing for the Germans. They could pick that up and home right on in it, so they got within visual range and shoot the aircraft down. We also had another device in the aircraft called Boozer. And this was tuned to the Wurzburgs and the Liechtenstein frequencies. And on a Wurzburg, if you were picked up with that, you'd get an orange side light that indicate guns. And if you got a red light, it was a night fighter coming in as well. It was a passive device, and they found it useful, but it got to be, if you got a shot in the damn thing and the light came on, there was you'd corkscrewing all over the sky and there was nothing there. So they eventually switched them all off. I'd mentioned before that the Peenemünde site, with the jamming on that, but I'll skip on to that one. July 24th, 1943, some of you may have been on this mission. It started on the night raid. This was the first time we were free to use window. Window's rather like the tinsel you have on the Christmas tree. it's cut to half the wavelength of the equipment we want to jam. It was going to be used to jam the Wurzburg radars. And we dispense it at the rate of so many bundles a minute. It was usually the engineer's job, and he would stand by the flare ship and just shove these bundles out because they'd puff and they'd come down like almost like confetti in a way over the city. Now, to give you some statistics, Hamburg was a very heavily defended city. If you guys went there in the daytime, you know what it was like. They had 54 88 millimeter guns defending it. They had 20 radar Wurzburg boxes there. They had 22 searchlights. They had 6 night fighter airfields full of fighters. And on that first night of the raid, they sent 791 aircraft, 347 Lancs, 246 Halifaxes, 125 Stirlings, and 73 Wellingtons. And the bomber stream was 200 miles long and 20 miles wide. 45 of the aircraft returned before getting there because of malfunction, one wasn't of the other. But by using window, the loss rate dropped to 1.5%. They lost 12 aircraft all told. 4 Lancasters, 4 Halifaxes, 3 Stirlings, and 1 Wellington. And normally we'd get about a 50% aircraft loss, so that was a major breakthrough. And of course, from then on, the fire was started there, 8 Air Force came in the daytime, and the raid lasted 2 days, and the city was pretty well destroyed. That's where the first firestorm occurred, and the next big one, of course, was 1945. And the final thing I'd just like to touch base on is a couple of things. We were working with the Americans on the radar development side. A bunch of guys who'd finished the tour in B-17s were suddenly told they were going to be flying B-17s again, with working with the RAF, and they formed their own section under 100 group. And they were 803 Bomb Squadron. They flew B-17s and eventually switched to B-24s. They also got the message and took the ball turrets out on that because they were absolutely useless at night, too much light reflection. They also used them in carpet bagger operations, and we have that buddy of mine that came down and told you about that. The final thing I want to mention are two items. One is called G, of course, and GH, and OBOE. OBOE was a code name for a very accurate bombing device. It was designed by the Brits, of course, and we had to use mosquitoes. But you could only use one aircraft at a time. And what it did, there's two stations, a CAT station. I'll just skip quickly through it. Here. This is your CAT station down here, and your mouse station up here. The mouse station would transmit a signal. And we're talking in terms of the speed of light, microseconds. A microsecond is about a millionth of a second, and that's your speed of light for the radio transmission going out. If you know the exact distance, and these two guys are cartographers, they would plot on the map the exact position here. We've taken Essen in this one, and it's exactly 262.22 miles from the mouse station here. And he would transmit signals. The pilot would fly east until he'd hear nothing but dots, until he got a steady tone. And he'd turn right, he'd fly down that curved line here. If he went beyond the curved line over here, he'd hear dashes, simple dot dash like Morse code. He'd continue down here, 10 miles from the target point, he'd be talking to the guy at the mouse station here. The pilot would then steer a set course. Everything about this was all pre-planned and briefed before they left the ground. So they'd know the height the mosquito was at, because with this thing it was limited to range because of the curvature of the earth. So 300 miles took in the Ruhr, which is right around here. So we were very, very accurate with this. Knowing the trajectory of the flares that we'd be dropping, but they didn't drop bombs, they would then mark the target completely accurately to less than 100 yard error, from 35,000 feet. And the bomb aimer sat back here because he would trigger the signal pulse and let the bomb go up of the flares as we were using. That way they would light up the target and the pathfinder would come on. Force would come in, identify the aiming points, build up from there. The genius came along when the guy that reversed that technology, this is what it was like on the screens, and he came up with GH. And he just modified it, and instead of having just the two stations, we still had them, but we only controlling one aeroplane, we fitted up the bomber with an extra switch on the G box, and he could then switch to these two cat and mouse stations, and that way he could accurately bomb each individual aircraft. So it worked very, very well. The Americans were doing this in the daytime. They got those GH sets in by end of 44. So they were doing exactly what we were doing at night, extremely accurately indeed. And just to summarize on how a night bombing raid would work, you had different types of raids we would do at nighttime, depending on the weather. We could bomb cities, not accurately at night, but cities are pretty damn big, so you're going to hit something anyway, through cloud. And we'd use a technique called Wanganui. We would drop parachute flares, very brilliant, and they would be seen in the cloud. Theoretically, when the bomber was looking through his bomb sight at the flare, if you could see the ground, you'd be aiming at the actual target. It wasn't particularly accurate because they're going to be affected by the wind as they drift on down. That was one you'd use if the weather was really bad, you couldn't identify the target. Normally, the type of attack you could either use the mosquitoes, accurately marking the target, blind bombing, regardless of the weather, and of course the main force could win. You could see the markers on the ground. Normally, in a raid, a main attack would be a New Haven attack, is the code name for it, and that one is the mosquitoes would go out with a squadron of 623, I think it was, mosquitoes. And they were practiced dive bombing every day. They didn't have a bomb site, they just had a grease point chalk mark on the windscreen that applied. It's a windshield, which is a flat one. I think one in the bombing version. And they would dive bomb on targets, and their accuracy was dead on every day. They practiced every day whether it was a raid that night or not. They would go out and be synchronized with the Pathfinder force coming in, who would drop flares and illuminate the whole city. They would then come down from 30,000 feet to about 5,000, maybe two, maybe three of them, and circle the target area and visually identify the aiming point. They'd pick something like a big soccer field in the middle of a city, drop their marker flares right on the aiming point, then they'd climb up about 5,000 and circle the target, and they would act as traffic controllers. They were the master bomber. They'd talk to us in the main force on the VHF radio, and say, bomb the red target indicators. Once they've bombed that area and saturated it, overshoot by 2 or 3 seconds, then they'd take that section out, or the backers up would come in every 5 minutes, drop more flares, different colors. It'd be greens, reds, yellows. Very, very bright. You could see them through the smoke. So that way they could saturate a city and just control the whole traffic. Very effective way of doing it indeed. So these were the two main techniques that we used. Other times, H2S, Parramatta was another one that we'd use when the marking would be done by Pathfinder Force using nothing but H2S, which wasn't overly accurate. The New Haven attack is the best one of the lot. So I just about run out of voice and I think I've run out of my time. Yes, Harry?
Were you involved with Dresden?
No.
Okay.
No.
Now, you were speaking of colors, circles.
Yeah.
Red and so on. Yeah. When I got there, we would hear a purple alert. That meant seek shelter. Mm-hmm. Don't look at the damn thing.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's what the meaning. The radar for purple was that they're that close.
No. What you were seeing at night, when you dropped your bombs, every aircraft.
I'm talking about the V2.
Oh, the V2s.
Yes.
Oh, coming into Britain.
Coming in.
Yeah. That would be, there was no way of knowing when they were coming in, a V2. A V2 came in at supersonic speed.
A V1, I'm sorry, V1.
Or the doodlebugs, yeah.
Yeah, ramjet.
Yeah. That would vary depending on, I'm not familiar with Fighter Command at that time, what they did down there. As I'm from Yorkshire, we never had any of that stuff for Irish base. So, I can't help you with that. Anyway, if you'd like to stretch your legs and wrap this up shortly. Yes, Mike.
That circular array you showed us, was that the one that they went into Bovaris to snag it and take it back to England?
Did
they want the array or just the black boxes?
No. They didn't need the array, they just needed the transmitter sets and the amplifiers to get the frequencies. The actual dish didn't worry about it. But we got that in North Africa with a Freya radar. That's the one we used to practice up in Scotland to make sure this D-Day thing would work. and it worked very, very well. That's when they got to go ahead to go and do it. And that was a massive operation. An awful lot of aircraft involved, didn't there? But it
always
worked. Yeah. Anyway, that will do it. Yes, yeah.
Ken, I was on a B-17 crew, and we became a GH lead crew.
Yeah.
And my last 10 missions, we flew nothing but GH, and the navigator dropped the bombs.
Yep.
Because he was running the GH.
Yep. When his blips lined up,
We had three different transmitters,
yep,
and the lines, they all transmitted at the same time, yep, and they picked a target where all three lines would cross at the same time.
Yep. Exactly, yeah.
And that's where we would drop our bombs. It was very accurate.
Exceptionally so. Anyway,
Nikobine. German? Nikobine?
I'm sorry?
The Germans used that.
Nikobine?
Nikobine, yes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. And it was very well.
Yes.
That's what they were using against Coventry in the early days.
Right.
So if you like to stretch your legs and have a little coffee or whatever.
Thank you, Ken.